short break, but I want to explain. Just sit, sit, just what I call this is the sacred art of the Ori. Now, I'm going to say something, and I want you to hold this. If you don't listen to anything else I've said, just take this. It's that don't let anybody tell you what art is and what art is not. You define your own art. Now, when I started painting on human bodies, somebody told me, but that's just body painting. Why? Everybody has done that before. Yeah. It's no big deal. I was able to tell the person, tell people that what I'm doing is different. I'm not doing body painting. What I'm doing is I'm taking the culture, just what I've done on the canvas, I'm putting it on human bodies. So the body is a canvas right in front of me. So a lot of times we are torn between, it's a place, everybody gets there at some point in their career as an artist. We get to a place where we're not sure what before we're doing is fitting into a mold. You don't care about that, just do it. Don't care about the mold, there are no molds, just do what you want to do. I know this might sound a little bit out of the box, but this is actually how I got to where I am today. I did not go to school to study art. I'm an attorney, human rights attorney. And I did that for 3 to 4 years, 4 years, before I quit and I focused on my art. Now, I mean, a lot of people told me, asked me though, did you think about why are you like leaving like the law career? Like I got something, I got a job, I got everything. I got paid, but then I wasn't satisfied. Something about every artist that steps out of you is that you're never going to be satisfied with anything until you get back to art. That's the only thing that's going to keep you alive. And if you found that, then just do it. Because you're just wasting your time doing any other thing you want to do. I know I'm saying this because I didn't get someone to tell me that on time when I was a lot younger. But then, I mean, I found it out myself because every other thing I did was a waste of time. I was never satisfied. Every time I went to art exhibitions, I just broke down. Because I was like, I can do this shit, but I didn't have a chance to do it. I'm sure some people feel that same way. You're just like, I know I can if I actually apply myself to this, but then you're not doing it because you haven't taken out the time to actually focus on your craft. So, back to the sacred art of the Ori. I've always known in my, like all my life, I've always wanted to be an artist, but society, I found myself, I grew up in Nigeria, and it's so different from America. A lot of times I'm too jealous, I wish I grew up in this country, because I teach people in Brooklyn, and I see a lot of parents who bring their kids to me, are like, oh, you know, I want, he or she wants to be an artist. I mean, tell them something, I encourage them, I teach them stuff, and I'm just so excited to teach kids. And sometimes I'm like, I wish my own parents did this to me, because right from the time I was born, I think my dad is also an attorney, and he just told me straight up that, you know, when I was old enough to understand, like, you're gonna be an attorney, you know, like, you know, this is a family tradition, you know. So I was just caught up in that mix for a long time because his brother was also an attorney. You know, either you're a doctor in Nigeria, an attorney, you're an engineer, because basically you do all these things because, you know, nobody has time for art because people are so scared because it's like, how are you going to make money at the end of the day? Because that's always the reason why people don't want to do it, because they're so scared. But then if that's the only thing that is your core, that makes you sane, then by all means do it. Because wherever you find yourself, you're always going to have to trace yourself back to that core, which is art. That means you're an artist. So it took me a while to find that, and eventually I did. Now, I'm sure a lot of people are going to ask me here how I got to work with Beyonce. Anybody wants to know how that happened? Okay. The moment I discovered myself and found out who I was and I applied myself to it, there's that law of attraction in the universe. It sounds cliche, but it's true. Like, people are going to find you. I did not network with anyone. I moved to New York in 2013, and I moved straight from Nigeria, and I met a lot of people, but then wasn't like I met somebody who just linked me up and be someone. But what I did is just apply myself to my craft, and then I adopted the motto, which is everything is my canvas. So I try to put my get my art into galleries, but now people ask me, you don't have an agent, who's your agent, who are you talking, you know, stuff like that. Just made it very hard. So I was like, okay, we're just gonna put art in everything, and let's see how far it goes. You know, so I got jackets, shoes, bags, everything. I just put art on anything and everything I could find myself. If I found a wall, I put art on it. So, I mean, for an artist, it's not much about, it's about your craft, but then it's about dedication to it. Like, you lose yourself totally. You become some kind of cycle. You're so much about your art. People are like, what is wrong with you? But then you just keep doing it because you don't give a fuck. Sorry to use that language. You don't give, at the end of the day, it's about you. It's about what you're able to create, what you leave the world with. Because a lot of, I see a lot of young people carrying a lot of ideas, you know. Trust me, this is like, for me, this is my craft. I hacked it. Sitting here, everybody has like different styles, different things like you know you have that you can do. But then you don't have the courage to do it because you're waiting for a validation from somewhere. It's not gonna come. It's gonna come from you at the end of the day. So you have to validate yourself. And you know, sometimes a little bit of, the borderline within arrogance and I don't know, but you just have to know within your heart that this shit I'm doing is dope, and that you know that you know. I mean, the person next to you might not think it, but then it just takes time because you just keep improving yourself, day in, day out, commitment, day in, day out, commitment, day in, day out, and then at the end of the day, it's just a matter of time. Become, because a lot of times when I'm in New York now, I'm in the subway, people want to take photos with me. I'm just like, who the hell do you want to take photos with? Who am I? Like, I don't see myself as anything. But the thing is, people recognize my work when they see it. And why do they recognize it? Because I put it in their faces. It's what I do, it's my art, it's my style. So you can't take that away. Every artist, everyone has that style. And I don't know why I'm talking like this, but I know somebody needs it here. I know somebody might just be encouraged by this. So, still gonna get to Beyonce. Beyonce follows my Instagram. It's crazy. It's really kind of crazy. And I got a call from Parkwood, and they were like, "Oh, we love what you do, and we'd like you to be part of the project. You know, Lemonade, blah blah blah." Of course, Nigerian in me, I thought that was a hoax. I thought maybe somebody was just lying. I was like, "This can't be true, because how would you like Beyonce? Like, how does that even happen?" So I asked for a face-to-face meeting. Like, "Oh, we're gonna book your flight, you're gonna come to New Orleans though. You have to leave New York." And they made me sign a non-disclosure. I was like, you know, it just sounded very weird. But I saw, they gave me a call sheet and they gave me all these names. I saw a lot of celebrities on, and I was like, oh shit, this can be real, might be real. You know, and I told my team they couldn't tell anybody. You know, it was like a secret, you know, mission, that kind of thing. So went to New Orleans. The moment I got to the airport, the chauffeur came to pick me up. I went to the hotel. Oh, when I got to the hotel, I knew it was real. You know, I got to my hotel room, I broke down, and I was just like, wow, it's insane. And you know, I just thought about all the time that I almost gave up on myself. All the time, people told me, no, you can't do this, you know. And then I'm going to be meeting Beyonce in the next like 3 hours or something like that. And then I get to meet this woman. She was like, "Thank you so much for coming." I'm like, "Why are you thanking me?" Like, you know. And she told me, you know, "Oh, I really loved your jacket, the one you posted 2 weeks ago. And I like your shoes. I like that." And it was just unbelievable that she actually paid so much attention to what I was doing. So I always tell people that, you know, you never know who's looking at you, who's watching you, who's just keeping tabs, just watching you. Because I meet people now who, like today, I mean, somebody said, "I've watched your career blow up over the years." Like, they knew when it was before Beyonce, before I did something with Nike, before I did something with Empire. You know, people already knew me because they watched me. So people are watching you. So what you owe yourself is never to give up, never to stop. That's what I tell people. That's the only secret to success. Never stop. Even when it feels like the odds are against you. When you're low, when you're down, just keep doing it. And when she told me what she wanted to do with the project and, you know, what she feels she wanted, she just told me that she loved what I was doing and she wanted me to do me, just to come do what I love to do. You know, it was like a check. I was like, and I'm getting paid for this. I was like, my name is going to be on this. You know, it was just crazy. It was too good to be true. And you know, at the end, everybody was so excited when I, you know, the moment I finished painting the dancers and her and a couple of other people, and they shot the scene. I mean, the guys behind the cameras were like, this is so good, this is so good. And they were so excited. You know, I could tell from their faces and their reaction that this was gonna be like a game changer. So everybody was like, oh, you know your life's gonna change, right? You know, you're working with the queen, blah, blah, blah. And everybody around them was like, everybody gets real crazy and caught up in the whole mix. But I wasn't like, not like a huge, I love her music, but I'm not like a, like I meet people every day who like, oh my God, you walked Beyonce, did you touch her skin? How did you feel? How did you feel? So you touch her, you know, people ask me all the time, can I get all the markers you painted? Can we buy them? You know, things like that. And people are so, you know, excited about it. And that just made me understand the fact that sometimes all you need is someone to take a chance on you and your life never remains the same. You just keep doing it. You just never know. You just never know. That's the hope I always tell people, that, you know, if I didn't leave my comfort zone, if I didn't leave my job, if I didn't, you know, work on myself, then, you know, there are no chances. You just have to take a chance. And there are no guarantees. That's just the truth. It's life. So I hope somebody has learned something. And I hope you understand what I'm saying. I'm just trying to be real, you know, as much as I can. So if you guys have any questions for me, feel free to ask me. And yeah, cool.
Do you have any regrets?
Regrets?
Yeah.
I wish I started earlier.
Do you wish you hadn't become a lawyer?
Well, sometimes I think if I had, you know, just, and there was a point I was in my fourth year, I was like, yeah, I'm quitting this. I don't want to do this anymore. Of course, it was going to tear my family apart because my dad was like, come on, man, like, just do what you just do it. And, you know, my mom was like, oh, even if you do this, they're going to think you're crazy or you think you can't do it, like you're smart, you're blood. And people who are not in like law school will like look at me like I don't value what I have. You know, like
yeah.
I was just this kid who was crazy, you know. I wish I had taken that step though. Sometimes I wish, but I mean, after my cult bar and I started practicing as a human rights lawyer, I understood my privilege and I was able to help people. And, you know, people I met, because I specialize in women and children, and I met people who had serious issues, people I had to help out of, you know, you have to choose between, you know, going to school and actually, you know, marriage. You know, the serious issues with child, you know, bride in Nigeria, northern part of Nigeria. I was able to help people, although, you know, it was a lot of burden on me. And the only way I could actually sometimes deal with this burden sometimes was to make art. So if you see some of my earlier stuff from like 2007, 2008, 2009, I did a lot of work around women and children. I have some work in charcoal. I have some about, you know, women rights, about human rights, about violations and stuff like that. So, I mean, it was good in the sense that it kind of directed me and opened my eye to something I would otherwise not know. So, everything, I mean, everybody's life has a different, you know, direction. So, wherever you find yourself, if you have a strong conviction to do something, sometimes just do it. It's crazy, sounds crazy, but it is what it is. Yeah?
What inspires you to create?
A lot of times it's, my mythology, where I come from. I'm Yoruba is the Western region in Nigeria. Nigeria is part of West Africa. And, we have a lot of stories that are not been told. A lot of stories about, you know, for example, Yoruba mythology. And sometimes I like to, like, when you see her face, for example, there's a lot of symbols. Like, you see the water comes in spiral and goes straight into her nose. And then you see the marks right here, the triangle. It means balance. Balance in Osho. Osho is a deity, it's like she's a goddess, like Venus in Greek mythology. Osho is about her beauty, it's about water, it's about birth, it's about life, it's about the beginnings. And I like to explore some of these like things in mythology to actually show people what Yoruba mythology looks like. Because when I was growing up, nobody, like literally, we were taught about Greek mythology, but we're not taught about our own mythology. So you have to do your own research. And it's part of the messed up things about colonial powers. You know, they kind of just, when they go to a place, they colonize you and they take your culture. Like, they tell you, this is a Christianity, it's kind of monolithic religion. So when you get there, they tell you, oh, everything about you is bad, it's evil, something like, you know. So they kind of convert you to Christianity. And Christianity doesn't allow any other gods or mythology or anything. So it's either you believe in Jesus or you're going to go to hell. So people were scared, you know, into believing in Christianity. Meanwhile, they kind of threw the baby away with the water. So the culture was kind of submerged for a while. But then, you know, if you, now there's a new wave, you know, like people are beginning to dig deep and, you know, there's a lot of culture, a lot of, like, I don't know, movies to be made about some of these stories because I find them very interesting. So I like to tell stories like that with my art. And also I'm inspired by situations and what's happening around us. And also by everyday happenings, you know? That's what inspires me, so.
How did you choose your art style or find what you wanted to work with?
I created my art style. I started that in 2007. I called it Afro Mysterics. And what it means is the mystery of the African thought pattern. So when you look at my work, you're gonna see a lot of patterns. You see mystery, you see mythology, you see a lot of things like in it. So I'm a storyteller. I like to tell stories in my art. So that's how the art style was born.
Yeah, but what made you choose this above something like painting or sculpting or anything else like that?
I actually have some sculptures. I have tried a lot. I've tried oil, wood sculptures, metal, leather, and I just keep exploring. Eventually, I found I'm very good with charcoal, ink, acrylic. I could use any tip on any surface. Basically, it's one of the, some of the things I discovered about my art is that I could actually use tips a lot, and I could actually go into great amount of detail without having to, you know, stress about it. So sometimes you just need to understand your powers. You know, we as artists, we have our superpowers. We have, you know, points, you know, you have like great advantage at, and just maximize it. You know, this is a good idea. Anybody else?
I have a question over here.
Okay.
When you decorate clothes, do you ever make your own clothes, or do you just like find like things at thrift shops and stuff like that?
That's how I started.
Okay.
Found things at thrift shops. Now I make my own clothes.
Now you can do.
Now I have a couple of people I collaborate with, like brands.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I got a call from Nike to make t-shirts and limited edition posters and shoes.
So you designed this?
Yeah, I designed that.
Okay.
So they printed that on fabric. So it's Nike in collaboration with Laolu.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. And we'll see, right? Yeah, cool. Thank you.
Yeah, so when you're working and you're working with a subject,
uh-huh.
Do you have a relationship with that person that influences the art that you're making, or do you come in with it with your ideas of what kind of symbols you're going to use for your model?
It could be any, it could be either way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is what is kind of interesting about working with the me as a model, is sometimes I vibe off her or whoever I'm working with, to actually like get energies or get, you know, things I'm feeling right there and then. For example, I have like this artwork in my studio with different orishas and different symbols and patterns on it. So if we get a vibe from you, for example, there's this orisha as a god, one of the Yoruba gods, Shango. Shango is very similar to Thor. He has a hammer. It's like that. This mythology has existed for more than 3,000 years. We don't know who copied him. If it's Scandinavian mythology, copy Yoruba or Yoruba. I mean, that's open to our debate. But he controls thunder with a hammer, and the hammer are kind of beads. And also he's able to spit fire from his mouth. He's the third ruler of the Yoruba kingdom. We call him Obakoso. That's what we call him in Yoruba mythology. Now, He's also great, known for his great prowess for organizing. Also, he likes to go to war. He's he organizes people, gives them language. He's also very, very quick to anger. Now, we have different deities like that. We have Shango, we have Obatala, who's the wise one. We have Orunela, which is a diviner. We have Oya. Oya was the wife of Shango. We have Ososi, which is brother of Ogun. We have Ogun. We have Elegua. So all these different deities with different patterns and everything, they have characteristics. So if you're talking to me, for example, I vibe with you, I can get different elements from all these deities. Whatever I vibe, like you, you're more like. Because we always say we ourselves are all Orishas, we are gods walking the earth. That's what we're battling with. So I take some of these elements and put them on the skin. So it pretty much transporting you back in the day and putting you in the battle.
Are there any similarities or differences in the way that people respond to your work in America versus back home?
That's very interesting. Of course. At first, people were scared because my art is not that mainstream in Lagos, in Nigeria, because what I do is pretty much I dig beneath the surface. Now, if you go to Nigeria, you see art. You might not see something like this on the mainstream. You see, I'm trying to see now. Anybody traveled to Africa before? Anybody traveled anywhere? Okay, where did you go?
Ghana.
Ghana, okay, cool. Did you see art related to mother and child? Did you see art? You see a lot of money. You see like houses and stuff, like sunsets and yeah. There's a very peculiar type of art when you go to all these cities like the park, which is just for tourists. So when tourists go there, they think, ah, this is the art. But no, there's a lot more than that, but you have to find it. So what I've done is I've brought it to the Western world, but now people kind of shunned it back home. Now want it so bad that they're like, oh, when people saw the painting of Beyonce, they'll be able to get, yes, that's Yoruba culture. And in my mind, I'm like, so where have you guys been all the time? You know? And somebody even wrote like a very nasty piece about Beyonce appropriating the African culture. And I mean, it's just been back and forth. And I'm like, how does that even make sense? How can an African appropriate African culture? We're just on different sides of the Atlantic. It could be you, it could be anyone who was sold into slavery who might find themselves anywhere in the world. So, I mean, nobody wanted to move the way Africans moved at that point, but it happened. So Africans cannot be said to appropriate African culture. So I had to put that in check at that point. So, yeah, hope I answered your question. Any other question?
Like, what's like something that you want to accomplish as an artist in the future?
Yeah. I really want to take this art to my next level is to put the art in museums and also libraries so people can visit them. I want to do something that's going to inspire people for the future. You know, that's my goal eventually.
In the future, when you're, like, I guess, long gone,
yeah.
What mark do you want to make in the world? Like, what do you want to, what, like, legacy do you want to leave behind?
Yeah, I want my time to be defined by the amount of art that I've created, basically. So, like, I don't stop. I just keep turning out art, like, every day. Like, every day, if I'm not traveling, if I'm not doing anything, but like it's harder now because I have to be like in different parts at the same time. So a lot of things I've done now, I'm happy I made a lot of art before. I won't call it fame, notoriety, but yeah. So I have a lot of art to show. So a lot of places, like I have an exhibit at the Pyramid Museum right now, and I have some work there, and I'm just happy works are there. People go there. They call me like, oh, I saw your work here. And people are excited by it. I want to have to be able to display art like in multiple places without having to move art from place to place. You know, so yeah, I just want to be able to create more art, and because I mean, I already found why I'm here, because so I hope somebody else will find why they're here, and in that way we can make the world a better place. Because when I understand my why, I just keep doing it. And right now, I know, you know, the reason why I'm on earth is to make art, to beautify, to make people feel better, not to start conversations. So yeah, just keep making art to love.
Do you have any
advice
for thoughts about American artists who create work that's based on, like, you know, where they are from in Africa, even though they've never been or they are not, were never similar in that culture? And, like, how does that art, the art that they make, compare to the art that you make?
You ask me to shoot an American artist. Well. You know, a lot of people make art about different parts, places where they've never been. I'll give you an example. In Nigeria, I have rappers who create art. Rap, make poetry about Brooklyn. They've never been to Brooklyn. They talk about guns, they talk about, you know, drugs and doing stuff. They never lived that life, but they're trying to create that art. Because and some of them do it so well that I'm scared. I'm like, are you sure that you haven't lived some kind of, but it's all about art at the end of the day. People can create art. Art should not be really based on where you're from. But then there's a very thin line in, like, you know, professing something that is untrue. For example, saying we are all from Egypt or using Egyptian symbols on every type of art, which is, I find it very, sometimes I see art and people say, oh, we are all kings and queens from Kush. And I'm like, no, we are not all from that place. You know, like, I could trace my family history and I know where I'm from in Jabode. And I have, we're not kings. Like, I was in my parents and I'm like, so there's that, you know, I hate to say this, but you know, coming to America, I've messed a lot of things up. That movie messed a lot of things up. Yeah, because a lot of things in that movie is not true. But, you know, I mean, it's, no, like, how do I say this? Without offending anyone. Because I think, okay, I'm not on camera, actually, I'm just going to say it.
You are.
You know. When I first moved to the States, and people were like, yo, brother man, you're from motherland, you're from Africa, yo. And I'm like, yeah, I want to go to Africa, man. I'm like, what country? Africa, bro, Africa. I'm like, yeah. You know, that whole concept of Africa really doesn't, like, exist the way people think it does. Because, trust me, for me to go to South Africa as a Nigerian, I have to get a visa. Americans don't need a visa. Does that make sense? So sometimes it's easier for Africans to move around in Europe than even in Africa. So the world is much more complex than it looks. She's from Kenya. A round of applause for Becca. She's my sister, but things for me to go to Kenya, I have to get on a plane for several hours. Time difference is crazy. Lifestyle, everything is totally different from where I'm from. So, you know, people who take the art in, you know, represent Africa that they might really not know without doing research might be kind of misinformed, because for people who don't really know about it, you know, then you misinform people, because then people don't know, because people want to know. So a lot of times I like to shed light to some of these things, because when people don't know about certain people, then, you know, people take you know, ignorance as knowledge, and then they kind of replicate itself. Because art is also supposed to inform people, you know, to also actually teach people, about a place. And, you know, why I take, Africa has kind of been one of the most misconstrued or misinterpreted continents, like, over time. People say also the things about Africa. People ask me also, you're from Africa, you see a safari. I never saw a safari in my life till I came to the United States. Ever. So there's this, you know, everybody thinks different things about, you know, if you come from Africa, you know, you must have a certain lifestyle. But, you know, it's not always the case. So a lot of people have different perceptions, but then sometimes I always tell people the best way to actually view the continent is to go for yourself. Just take a trip if you can. Whenever you have the means to, just go around the continent. You're going to have no one's going to be able to take your knowledge away from you because you're going to have the first-hand knowledge. Just like a time travel. That's what I'm going to say. And you experience the art too first-hand. So. Yeah.
There's a gentleman over there that's
been
talking.
Oh, cool, bro.
So, like, I've noticed, like, in your style, it's, like, white paint on the black skin. Is that, like, a staple? Or, like, could it be translated in any way? Or is that, like, something that is, like, solid in your style?
Plus, your hair is, like, burnt. That's cool. there's something about the white paint on black skin. Now, ancient times, like I used to watch my grandmother paint herself before she passed in 2001. A lot of things that I do now, I learned from her. Then, something so very spiritual about some of the paint, the white that you put on black skin, is that the melanin eventually becomes the paint when you look at it properly. It's not about the white paint. It's a negative kind of spacing when you look at what's on the face. The lines are dark, not the white. Does that make any sense?
Mm-hmm. Why that make any sense?
You know what I'm saying? Okay, I'm gonna explain that now. Now that is different. When I'm painting on another skin tone, I use other colors. Same thing with blacks, I use other colors. It all depends on what I'm doing. For example, if I'm doing the secret art of the world, that is different. Do you understand that if I'm actually hired to come to work on like a movie set, it's totally different. I still use my style, but then it's different. I'm working for a project, like there's a picture in mind, and I'm supposed to be part of that picture. Does that make any sense? But if I'm doing something like in spiritual, I'm connected with my muse, then it's very different. Sometimes when I do this, very simple, it's black, it's white, it's black. Sometimes I use red, sometimes I use blue, sometimes I use black, it's white, so. Not bad. Yeah.
That's how I got another question. What was your like support system in terms of like art? What was it like before you kind of like before people started like noticing you, like what was your support system like then, and how was your like networking?
You mean like family?
Family, anybody supporting your art?
Like, oh yeah, cool. Like, family didn't care. My dad didn't care. No, I'll be real with you. My dad didn't talk to me for a while. I thought I had a brainwave, and it was like, oh, you gotta get back to your senses, you know, get back to your job, real job that pays you. So, I mean, it took them a while. Now they're very proud of me. Got my pictures hanging in the house. My dad's always, dad's always talking about you to all his friends. That, oh, my son is the one, to, you know, so forth. You know, people always come around eventually. You just need to be able to know people who are actually down with you. You find that out when you're like, you know, down in the dumps. People that don't kick you, people who appreciate you. Everybody, every artist needs a support system. And sometimes you have to find that outside your family, maybe their family and friends. Sometimes it's, you know, your partner, it could be anyone who's just down with you, ready to ride it off, no money, bro. This is real life, man. New York kind of taught me a lot of things, you know. You know, there are a few people who will kick you when you're down, and there are people who actually lift you up when you're down. You know, it's a very, you know, it's like this. And then when you get up there, everybody's like, oh man, remember me, bro? Man, we used to kick it back in the day. I was like, nah, we didn't. Yeah, cool.
So you said earlier that, like,
your
art works
on
stories.
Yeah.
What did you take
back in? Oh, shit. You want to start that? Okay.
Take it off.
What? You want me to take it off?
Yeah, so you can.
Oh, yeah.
There's the back, too, right?
Yeah, you want to put it on so that I can show you?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, cool. A round of applause for Becca again. She's like my, taking the turn around on the show. Now this is my roots omo ijebu oju gugu jale jale omo ni to ibo mi ile omo ni wura omo ni pepe. Sorry, I had to say that. Now that is Yoruba saying for saying somebody, my grandmother used to tell me that it means someone or my child that has something that the West does not have. Now, I didn't understand what she meant back in the day, but it's something I grew with and something that made sense eventually. Now, that is my face right there, the heart, and then the Shango patterns. And then you see this, like, there's a crown here and there's a pattern. Like what it means basically, this pattern, I am the king of my own destiny, and my own destiny is me. Now, you see these patterns, like I say about wearing Africa on our backs, you see African map, and then you see this person right here. Then you see masks by the face. These masks are symbols of the different Orishas which you communicate with, basically who take our prayers to the, it's just like, how do I explain that? It's like Christianity. Christianity goes to God through Jesus, and you know, God speaks to his people through Jesus, like an intermediary. So Yoruba people talk to Olodumare through the different Orishas. They have deities. Depends on the school you're from. You have like close to 301 to 401, depends. So all these masks represent different deities. And then the O in the eye means Ori. Ori is also your, like in your Ori is your head, is your eyes. The eyes are very important in my words, because there's this also a proverb in Yoruba language that says, Oju ni alakofin shori. Your eyes are like the window to your soul. Your eyes kind of are the ways people can actually see into you. They're like, I'm trying to break it down in English, and sometimes I don't find the words, but your eyes are what you protect yourself with. Like, you say, Kujumari Bikogbara Lugwe, it's more like, if you don't want to see evil, you move with your whole body, but then if you want to see, you have to like detect it with your eyes. So the head is very, very important when it comes to a lot of the work I do. So that's the map there, and then you see there's a person here, and then there's somebody right in between here crying tears. Like, this is like very symbolic of me and all the things I had to go through, the moments I had to cry, and sometimes you have to actually dig deep and turn your sorrow into your art, basically. And a tumble. And all this, all this is a lot of eyes, masks. It's like a party happening in front, basically. But it's like my own way of like, but the pots are very symbolic, because the pots are like mind pots. This is where you store your stuff. Like in your head, I feel there's always like the pots in your mind, basically. And that's where you store things in. Because there's nothing that goes in your mind that goes like into like emptiness. It's stored in there somehow. But then you have to at some point deep into that part of your mind to actually create. Yeah.
So I see that you're incorporating like some more modern things, like that car.
Yeah, Biddle.
What does that mean?
It's, you know, Ogun is a god of metal in Yoruba mythology. And anytime you see like a car, you see like a buildings, you see technology, it's actually reflected off the Orisha god Ogun. Yeah.
I have a question. So on the back.
What?
Girl,
so,
like, make me
too. Yeah. So on the back, is that, okay, so remember like, you had that it was on the crying? And is that a mother right there or a woman figure right there?
So I don't see. What else is there? What part are you looking at?
Yeah, it's right there. Yeah.
This one, right?
Yeah, and above it. Like, is that like supposed to be a figure of a woman or?
It's actually a man. You can see like a crown, wearing a crown right there, and then there's a heart. Now there's somebody on the side. There's always a mask on the side if you look, and then there's another part on the side. There's a man on the side. Now it's kind of really, it's like a proverb. It's a symbolic Yoruba proverb that tells you about your, like, right inside that guy who's standing right there, could be any one of us, but I just, like, mirrored myself. There are the low points, like, there's a face right in the middle of that point that is crying. Like, low points make the whole picture. Then there's this other side, there's a face mask, it's also facing that side. There are moments when you want to go this side, or you go this side. You know, or you go left or you go right. You have to like make a decision, but then you're right there in the middle of everything going through because you're facing it. Now, how do you know your destiny? We say something in Ayomo. We say something like, Olukalukulomo Ayomo Titi, as a Yoruba saying to that says that nobody knows tomorrow. All we see is today. But then you have to be able to know that your destiny is yours. What is yours. We have that, like, I don't know what to call it. It's like in my hands, is my destiny, is my palm. I can hold it. Now it's mine for me to determine. Now everything around me can be like chaotic and things might happen, but I still have my destiny in my hand. So a lot of times when you see the eyes closed, like in that image of a person, it's just somebody trying to make a decision. It has to do this or to do that, and at moments you have to cry. But then, man, it doesn't mean the end of your life. It's pretty much a lot of philosophy when it comes to Yoruba language that a lot of people, even back home, don't dig deep into, don't really use, but I always like want to be able to express that with art. You know, and then, I mean, the patterns are so amazing for me in my head. I'm just like, yeah, I have to fix it, put that thing, put this there, put that. You know, just to make everything like, you know, it's kind of flashing points like that. So that's kind of very interesting to the eye. And also anybody who's looking at it to actually see the contrast and the elements, the different parts of this. So I just
have a jacket.
Thumbs up.
You were talking about how you want to be like the memory of things like that in the future. And with a lot of like very functional work like shoes and coats and then body painting that doesn't actually last. Do you think that like photographs are something that you want to only be remembered by, or
do
you make any work that's strictly archival?
Like,
what do you do about that?
I have a lot of art on canvas, on pastel paper. But the thing about this is, this is actually hanging at the Grammy Museum. Jackets, all painted. So this can be framed. Anything can be framed. Pictures, the thing about body art is, it's like art of the moment. That's what is so special about it, because whatever is, whatever memory you have of it is that the pictures. And the pictures that I have right now have over, I think I have over 100,000 photos. Just sitting like, a lot of photos I haven't even shown the world yet. Of like people I've worked with that I can't even talk about. Like celebrities and stuff that I've done sessions with everything. You just keep putting them out bit by bit. So, for me, I mean, the documentation of photography is actually, all the ones I've seen is actually so good that it's actually very important for me to be able to work with photographers too, you know, because a lot of times when I'm doing the work, I work with photographers who understand what I'm doing. So there are people who take just behind the shoots, behind the scene photos, and people that actually take photos of the art. And I actually make sure I direct them to really take photos, what I want, and then the poses, and what I want to reflect, because at the end of the day, when they wash it off, it's all gone. So you do something else. So photos are very important ways I want to document my art. I also have a canvas, leather, shoes, a lot of things.
He did these on the train. We were bored. that's not dope.
So okay, cool. Hope I'm not boring you guys.
Is there any other like culture or anything like that that influences your artwork other than your own? And if there is, like, what are they?
Yes. I mean, I live in New York. Man, what's that word? Like, there's a lot of culture in New York that is just so amazing. Like, I get influences from different parts. People tell me things that sometimes resonate with me, but it's just kind of very, very, very unique in the sense like human beings have similar experiences all over the world, but it's just how we're so sometimes involved in our own culture that we don't get to see, experience other people. But the moment you speak to people or you travel, you're gonna see that everybody's just having a good time. At the end of the day, people just wanna have a good time. They want to be able to, you know, enjoy art, cultural stuff and everything. And when you look at patterns, look at masks, look at eyes, look at different things, there's a lot of similarity. But then I get inspired. I mean, I do a lot of works that have some Asian symbols sometimes, Chinese lettering. I've done a lot of that, and also the yin yang sign. I incorporated that a lot into some of my art. And also, I mean, New York City is a place. I mean, just the skyline alone just inspires me. Sometimes I've done a lot of art. The skyline, Brooklyn, oh God, Brooklyn, Biggie, the bridge. I did an artwork that was shown on the I don't know if anybody been to Barclays Center in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's that. Like, I had like a day. It was like a moment in my life because I never seen my art displayed on anything that big before. So I had like an hour where my art was going, like on that stuff. And it was just, for me, it was one of those things that, yeah, I was so thrilled about it. But then the art had different elements of Brooklyn in it. And something about my travels that have actually influenced my life and my art. So I get inspired by that. Okay. You're gonna ask that at the same time, right? Okay, you.
So you have such a wide portfolio and your work is very intricate and detailed. How do you keep moving forward and keep creating new things without getting sidetracked and without losing your focus so well?
I do get sidetracked. Yeah, I do lose focus sometimes. It's just natural. But you just have to find yourself again. I always like to try as much as possible to keep people around me that tell me that, okay, Laolu, this is what you're doing. I actually play music. I'm also a musician. And a lot of times I get like I'm working in the studio and I just want to be there. And I got work to do. Like, I got like, and I'm like, they tell me, oh, you got to be out of here like this time. So sometimes I don't want to do it because I'm so much in the moment, but then I have to. Because, man, it's, I mean, when you get there, thing is, sometimes I miss days when I just sat down and just created just because I didn't have anything to do. Does that make sense? Like, I don't have to be somewhere to create. I enjoy my life, I enjoy what I do, but some days you just miss just sitting down, just being lazy with your imagination, like literally just not thinking about anything. Your art is just so, I don't know. Like, right now I have a style. There was a time I really did not know what style I was gonna, I miss those moments. Like, I wanna get back there and explore something else. You know, but it's life. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Yeah, sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Like after working on Beyonce's video, when people look at that, they're like, I want you to just do exactly that. Which is hard, because I can't repeat that, you know, because I did that in the moment. But then I have to try for that, because I'm getting paid, hello. Yeah, okay, let's do that. So, I mean, that's for them, because that's what they want. It's what they require. So, you know, a lot of times it's having to balance, you know, creativity and business, which is one of the very hard parts of being a creative. It's, you know, the business side is always like very constricted, you know, to you're like, must I do that? You know, like really, okay, I don't want to do that. And then your team is like, got bills, and you're like, okay. So, I mean, but I still have my moments. I have like time just strictly schedule just to do me and do a project that I'm so passionate about. But then, you know, I have to work. So basically my work is art. So I have to get up and do it. You know, so yeah. Yeah.
So you've been talking a lot about traveling.
Yeah.
And earlier you mentioned that in Ghana or like other countries, mm-hmm. a lot of the artwork that you see if you're tourist there is made for you, like you're a tourist. But how, if you do travel to a country like that, how would you see more art that has been made by artists for themselves?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. Can you just...
So when you were talking about the mother and child and stuff, but, like how, and would you say that those aren't like the authentic art, or would you...
Okay, yeah. Okay, this question came up on Facebook recently. Somebody said, Would you advise anybody who's never traveled to Lagos before to go on their own? And for people who were Nigerians, were like, hell no. But as I see people who are not like Nigerians, who are not even Africans, comments like, oh, why not? Just go, you know? And in my mind, I'm like, how do you like, why are these people like saying, yes, you can go? Because for some of us, it's like, you need guidance, you know, when you're going to a territory where you've never been before. It's just like me coming to the United States for the first time. I didn't have somebody guide me because at first I'm like, well, what the hell is all this? Everybody's so calm, like a lot of times when I talk, I get so like I talk like this. I'm very loud and I shout. They say I shout, but that's how we are. You know, like someone say, don't raise your hands. You know, they might think you're, you know. Then when you're talking, don't look at people straight. I'm like, what? You know, like people feel uncomfortable sometimes by your mannerisms because that's just how like we are. We're kind of really loud, but we also joke. Like that's how it is in Lagos. Like Lagos people, that's how we are. Now if you go to Lagos for the first time, you need to understand innuendos. Like nobody will tell you some things. You just have to have somebody who's gonna guide you. Oh, don't do that. Oh, don't flash that dollar bill. Your dollar right now is 500 naira. So when you flash that, somebody's gonna think you have a lot of money and they're gonna try to take that. You know, people, you just have to be street smart. But if you don't know, then you don't. You're gonna fall in the, you know what I'm saying? Not that you're stupid or something, but it's because you don't know. So same thing with the art. Sometimes you need somebody who's gonna tell you that, oh, see, this is where the tourists go when they come. But then you have to go there, you can go to that gallery. They have a couple of artists who are actually doing some really dope stuff. Check them out. So sometimes that information can just be cool. You just need to make friends with the right people, you know, who are gonna take you to some of those places. Because a lot of times when you get to Nigeria, I can tell you, I mean, people just wanna make money. So when they see you, or they see, or you say, you just say, oh, I'm coming from America. All they see is dollar signs. Like, yeah, man, you come, you got it, you know. And then you don't have the real experience because you just want to make a quick buck to yourself.
The lady with the green afro that's
licking. Oh, sorry. Did I skip you? I'm so sorry. No, that wasn't intentional.
It's fine.
Yeah, you wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, I guess it was more just about like balancing business with your own art, and mm-hmm. especially what you were talking before about wishing you got to like explore things more.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I guess what tips would you have for artists who are still sort of in that like development stage while they're like searching for a style, like how to keep sort of that ability to explore while moving into like the business arena?
First off, the reason why we as artists do art a lot of times not because of money. It's because that's how we're able to live sane. Am I right?
Yeah.
Cool. If I wasn't creating art, thing is, something about art is that you fail at it first before you succeed. Because a lot of times it doesn't always generate income. If you were doing it for the income, then get out. So the first thing is to be very passionate and love what you do. To a point that whether you're paid for it or not paid for it, you're cool. When you get to that point, then you know you're good. Then you can. Then the business part comes eventually because people know you for your style or people value you. Eventually, they're able to exchange good money for your stuff because they know they can't get that stuff anywhere else except from you. So a lot of times, it takes a while to build a name. It takes a lot of time, a lot of energy, a lot of stuff, basically, a lot of ups and downs. But a lot of times, you just have to, one, also building a team around you is very important. Every artist needs people who are able to tell them the truth when they don't want to hear it. Because a lot of people also tell me that, oh, dude, this shit won't fly. but you know, you need people around who's going to tell you that. But then you know, how you know is that they're saying it from a good place. Because They're the ones who've been with you even when you're like, nobody really cared about your art. People would think you're so dope even when nobody ever thought you were dope. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So keep people like that. It kind of helps you grow. And also, when that time comes when you have to make these business decisions, you're going to know. And eventually, man, I believe everybody in this room, you guys are all very smart. I'm sure you're smart. You're smarter than I am. So, man, at this age, because the thing is, I didn't get this kind of talk. I just had to, when you chill, try this, try that, and try. I wish somebody has told me that, you know, just focus on this, and then when you get to this, you can always, because the thing is, focus on your craft. Just fall in love with the process. Just keep doing it. Eventually, that time will come when you're gonna have people who are gonna be able to invest in you, who see you as like, people see me like a brand. It's kind of crazy. See me as a brand, and they come to me with all these business ideas. I'm sitting in that conference room. I'm like, I'm bored, so I'm just jotting it. I'm just like, when is this business? Because I have people who are actually helping me out, making this. I ask them, do you think this will fly? Do you think this business decision is good? Should we make more t-shirts? Should we make more of this? Should we make shoes? You know, things like that. All artists are concerned sometimes is, I just want to be able to create, love what I do. People love what I do. It's acceptable. But at the end of the day, again, you know, you have to be able to balance what you love and also being able to make money. It's very, very tough. But at the end of the day, you gotta find your own ways. You're gonna find a way around it. But just keep creating. That's all I'll say. Because to be honest, I've just been blessed with people like this, people like Kay, people like Destiny, who work with me, who are just phenomenal. That's all I can say. They make me look like I'm some superhero, but no, I don't take any decisions without them. So, or else I'm just gonna look, you know, every artist, we just wanna create. Sometimes you're so fired up, you see something, you're like, shit, I love this, and you just focus and you drop every other thing and you just start doing that. And then they tell you that, what about this that you were doing before? Like, you're not done with that. Or, you know, because a lot of times I see a lot of artists that are very excitable, like get excited, passionate about something so quickly, and then you just drop everything. So your team is very, very, very important. Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
How does your music and your art intersect in terms of process and the way you think about it and what it means to you?
Yeah, I think I'm still failing at music, though.
It does sound good to me, the stuff I think.
What's it?
What I've heard sounds really good.
Yeah, so thank you. So much. Yeah, because I'm still trying to get to that point where people are able to hear my sound and identify that sound, see my art and identify it, and they be able to like put it together. Because a lot of times, you know, I get invited to shows. And they're like, I see the lineup. I'm like, I play music too. Like, nah, we just want to paint people. You know, because they can't, you know, they don't know you in that. So when you send them things you've done, they still find it hard. Like, was that you? You actually did that? Because the mind is very, very, I mean, sorry to use this word, but people in the industry are kind of very, sorry to even, I hate that word industry though, but. People like you to check boxes. People see you in a certain way. They see an artist and they want you to like, oh, this is what you do, and that's the only thing you're gonna do. So you have to be able to break free. Don't put yourself in the box. It's the worst thing any artist can do. Never ever allow them to define you, because once they define you, they constrict you. So you have to always keep like trying to reinvent yourself and just surprise people some of the time that, oh, I also do this, and just, you know? So, yeah, but I'm working on that, and my music actually, I have a lot of art now that I put in my, this new music I have out. It's called Mama Africa. I'll check it out on YouTube. You guys should check it out. It has probably like 3,000 views. But I think it's dope stuff. People don't just see, yeah, but I think it's dope stuff. In my heart, I think it's dope stuff. But it has a lot of art. It has a lot of my message, like a lot of the stuff. It's a very conscious song. He says, no mama, don't lose hope. So the rap goes like this. Goes going against gravity, rising and finding my way to the top. Femisile, Oludumari, Babaloke, show me the way to make it. Breaking the way like Otakite, Kilode, Timba celebrate, Edemi, Ashami, Iwami, Tobi, Misi, Mudagbasi, no jealousy, we cool as the breeze. You know? But, so. As artists, there are no boxes. You just let yourself go, basically. Don't let anybody go. You can do anything. Like, this world is the sky is big enough for you to fly, for everybody to be artists and be successful. So, yeah, that's where I'm at right now. So I'm still also trying to balance my life together. So.
Do you think your art would be any different, or just like what you create, if you were exposed to visual art and different mediums from an earlier age?
Yes. Could have. And might not have. It all depends on. Not that I wasn't exposed to art, though. It's just.
Or like encouraged.
Yeah, maybe if I was encouraged, yeah, maybe. If my dad was like, oh man, that's so good, you know? I remember we have this the system we had in Nigeria was like, we study everything by rote. So we had to commit everything to memory, basically. So I remember my report card. There was like, first position, second, third, fourth. And every subject had like the first, and they would show the person who had the first on your report card and everything. So I brought my report card home. You know, art, I was like first, you know. And my dad would just keep that. He didn't just see, like, he just went straight to my math, my English, my science, and everything. I was like, oh, you did bad here. Oh, you had an F, you had an E, or you were not first here. So, and I'm like, what about art? I was first. And he's like, come on, man. Like, you know, like, that didn't matter. But, you know, for me, I just needed somebody to tell me that you were actually good at that, you know, and maybe I would have been. Like, but I didn't get that. So I had to, like, camouflage, or, you know, had to learn what they wanted me to do and be that person eventually, which kind of, man, being a lawyer in Nigeria, it took a lot of time, like 10 years out of my life, like that, just to school. I read all these big books, which at the end of the day, I knew I wasn't going to use, but I just had to do it for family. It's what you do sometimes, but, I mean, it's not something I encourage anybody to do if they don't have to, but hey, it's life, man. Sometimes you just got to do some things, you know, for family, you get on with your life, so... I hope I'm making sense. I hope I'm not saying stuff I'm not supposed to say. I think, do we still have any more questions? Okay, cool.
So basically, I know that as an artist, you always kind of, like, as an artist, you just kind of, like, it's kind of, like, given that you're always going to be critical of yourself, you're always going to, like, put yourself down about certain things. So is there anything about your art that you, like, that you're, like, trying so hard to do, but you just don't seem to be at that place yet.
Do I feel that same way?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. I criticize myself, but then I don't let anybody see when I'm criticizing myself. You know, I'm just like, I know where I want to be at, and I just keep working on it. The thing is, as an artist, your success story is like a journey. The thing is, people see what you do at the end. There's also always the dope part that people see your art as dope. But before it was dope, it wasn't dope. Or it's like a gradual process. Like, you're always, because you know you're part of the process, you're not aware of your own growth a lot of times. We're so oblivious to it. So a lot of times we keep pushing ourselves and pushing us, which is good, because then you improve. You know, you're always like trying to get to that next better version of the artist, whatever you want to be. You just keep doing it. So a lot of times you just have to sometimes step back. It's hard, but you step back and actually, you know, celebrate yourself and raise a glass or something like, hey, you know. Yeah, because it's kind of good. Kind of encourages you, and you also want to, you know, continue on your journey. It's all a journey. Like, there's no, you don't wake up someday and just everything's just perfect. It's like you just keep trying. I'm still trying, and I just keep trying so that, you know, maybe, I don't know, I just keep trying. I keep trying. So.
Let's take a couple more. Just to end out, and then I'm going to save the last question for myself, if I don't mind.
Okay, go on.
We'll take one or two more, though. I thought I saw a hand over there.
Morning.
Hi.
Hi.
Did I not? Did I not? Did I say all?
Some came to me, and some people I hired them eventually when things got out of, like, I had to get people to work with me. Now, there were people back home in Nigeria when, like, I used to divide my time as an attorney. I used to work with human rights lawyers. So I went to office, 9 to 5, and I would come straight to the gallery and work sometimes from 5 till the next morning, sometimes very late in the night, sometimes we didn't have electricity. But I had this group of friends who would just hang out, you know, just, you know, talk about art, make music. They just, like, we just, like, always doing stuff that we loved, we enjoyed, because we were, like, we understood each other, could vibe, because we, a lot of people are not like that, you know, because I had a lot of other friends who were much interested in other things, you know, they wanted to go parties. I mean, it's not that I don't like parties, don't get me wrong, but there's some things that, like, we geek about, like, art, like, man, just screaming, you know, we see art, like, shit, how they, you know, they're trying out techniques, and I do stuff, they're like, man, that's so dope, you know, so people like that, and I had also this guy, his name is Osi. Osi was, like, my head, he was in my head, he was my curator, so he just enjoyed interpreting my art, you know, and what I just let him do is, when I did something, he'll just come, and he would just, like, look at it, I just start talking. Sometimes I just put out a tape recorder and I just record what he was saying because it just blew my mind. Because things I was not even thinking about, he said them. And sometimes he was like, he understood my art, not better, but he could actually, you know, he was like, he made me a better artist, you know? And people like that, I kind of just held them like very close because sometimes I just draw stuff and just send it to him, what you think? And he sends me like a whole, like, like, he just types up stuff, you know, and I'm just like, wow. And I just read it and then go back to the art. And then I send him, like, yeah, man, I love what you did. Or, like, this is really good. This is what I think. And you have this kind of exchange. So, I mean, people like that. Also, I met Kate at my gallery in Abuja. What she would do basically was just make sure everybody were not hungry. That kind of thing. You know, like, we would starve, just making art, and like, oh, someone just show up in like with food. I'm like, yay, all of us eat, that kind of thing. And also help, like take care of some of the exhibitions we had. You know, sometimes we had problems like putting stuff together, putting like exhibitions together. I had all these ideas in my head, so I was just so scattered. But there are people who were just like, oh, why don't we do this first? You know, just chill, you know, that kind of stuff. You need people like that. So I just kind of understand that, oh, this person did that and they did it so well. That's like a, I don't know, it's a kind of, I read a couple of books that made me understand. It's like a gift, but you have to be discerning to know people who actually help you be a better artist or people who are not, who are taking away from you, like to sucking up your energy away. So you have to be able to know people. It's kind of, I don't know how I did it or how I do it, but I kind of just have that discernment to be able to know, oh, I don't want none of this person, but you know, you are cool. And I'm just kind of from the clan, you know, which was outside my immediate family because at that point, I mean, my dad wasn't talking to me. So it was pretty much, those were the people I had. And I mean, today, I still have them. So. That's that makes any sense.
How would you advise artists?
The United States and, you know, just the Western world in general,
how would you advise them on exploring other art
from
other cultures and how
to navigate that? How to
explore art from
other cultures?
Respect it.
And explore. How do I tell artists from that's I just tell them to respect it. for example, you know how sometimes I, like, people say things like, or people who don't know, you know, it's from a good place, like, oh, I love your art, it's so tribal. I'm like, what's the definition of tribal? Now, that's a very problematic word. And it was brought by, for me, it's kind of disrespectful. And also it's a term that colonialists used, you know, back when they first arrived in Africa. Just called us like, oh, you're this tribe, and that's tribe, and that's tribe. You know, you can have a tribe of monkeys for all I care. There could just be five monkeys in the room. You don't call people with developed ethnicities developed for like close to 5,000 years and call them a tribe. I don't go to England and say, oh, what tribe are you? You know? So it's very complex, and that's why I tell people that because you don't understand my art, you don't mean you should give it a term. You should ask, and I'll tell you. Ask, and you shall be told. You know? So a lot of times, if you don't know, you have to understand that you do not know. Don't assume that you know because of your whatever you've been told. Because sometimes what you've been told might not be accurate. It's just like watching TV. And a lot of times, now I get it. When I see all these UNICEF adverts, and you see Africa as a help a child today, UNICEF, you know, the child, I'm not saying, I mean, but then I'm like, oh, wow, okay, this is Africa, some people think it is. But trust me, when you get Africa, you ain't gonna see none of that shit. I mean, people are just laugh at you like, really? I mean, there are parts that are torn, war torn, I know, but that is like a very tiny percentage. I mean, people are partying right now in Lagos. and when you get to, like, people want to leave, people are just like, I mean, New York is just like Lagos. It's just on a different level. A lot of times, people are about their business, people want to make money, everybody's happy, people are hustling, you know? So, you know, sometimes disrespect stems from stereotypes, or people have preconceived notions of what they think about a stereotype, or people what they think about art, which a lot of times might be wrong. A lot of times it is wrong. So I always like to, you know, tell them that don't call my art tribal. You can ask me what ethnicity I am. I'll tell you I'm Yoruba, and that is what it is. I don't belong to any tribe. So, yeah. I think, do you understand what I just said? Yeah, so, yeah.
I have one. I don't think you told us this, but what was the tipping point or the point where you said, okay, no more lawyer, I'm going to the grave here, I'm doing this.
It was in 2011. I couldn't balance my work and my life as an artist. Like, I would create for like hours on end, and I would get to the office like with like red eyes because I didn't sleep. So I couldn't function in both worlds. So sometimes I'm just like, man, this is gonna be hard, but yeah, I'm gonna be broke for a while. So I made a choice. I was like, I'm quitting. I just stopped going, sent my resignation letter like a month later. And they're like, oh, what happened? Like, you know, people were so, what broke my heart the most was not just leaving the job, was the people I was working with, like children, kids, women, children, people they used to call me like all times of the night and just call me like, oh, we have this problem, or there's this child who escaped from so-and-so place in Nasarawa State, it's close to Abuja, the federal capital territory in Nigeria, and, you know, the family already took money from some Alaji, you know, like a whole lot of money so that the child can be married to him as a fourth wife. I mean, something's not commonplace here, but it's a big problem. And sometimes with the Sharia law in Nigeria, which is customary law, which is kind of really weird. It's an Islamic tenet that actually allows men to marry more than one, two, three wives. And they could actually take a child who's like not old enough, but then they would say things like they would see them through school, pay for their school and everything. Like, that child's already grown to become that man's wife. So a lot of kids didn't have a choice. Like, age 13 or 12. You know, imagine having to make that kind of decision. It's just kind of so crazy. So, I mean, having to leave that, sometimes I felt like I betrayed them or something. But, you know, that was kind of just like my own way of dealing with some of the things they were going through was actually create art too. Because I could just, I couldn't handle some of those stories because it was too much for me. Because as a male child, you know, I didn't have to go through that. A lot of male children don't go through that. Why females have to go through that? So just kind of disturbing. I mean, it's still disturbing right now that even right now, we still have cases like that. So I had to like choose, and art was calling. And I just felt I could say more with my art than I could with my job because I was so limited in what I could do. So I chose art. And here I am talking to you.
I don't know, anybody have a burning one that just couldn't? I'm going to ask the last one.
Okay, sir.
A lot of these guys in here, they are just at the point where they're starting to be creative. They're past the technical aspects of it. They have a toolbox of skills to use, and they're ready to start with their own voice. But they're having a hard time with the fear, and they're having a hard time with just being honest. As somebody that made the decision to leave home, to go to another place, to do work about home, can you speak to them and give them some words that will encourage them?
First thing I'll say is that as artists, we all seek validation. Sometimes from peers, sometimes from, because the thing we create art, it's not all about ourselves sometimes, it's about people, it's in the art. And it's hard when the necessary validation you want is not coming your way. Sometimes you just have to stick it through because the validation you need is already within yourself. You already made a decision to be here. So, I mean, if you have made that decision and you know that you know that you know that you know. There's a core in everyone. It's hard, but the thing is, not all of us are gonna be artists. It's the truth. Somebody else is gonna find their core in some other thing, maybe it's baking or something, and that's what they wanted to do. You know what I'm saying? So it's something that you're gonna, like for me, I'll talk from my experience now. I knew right from a tender age that I was an artist, but then I wasn't allowed to express it. So I was always finding ways to go back to it. But eventually just, I did eventually. But then there's, I mean, all of us right now, we all know that thing that we excel at, that you know, there's a style of yours that you know that. That if you focus on this, no other person can beat you at it. Like it's something that you know deep inside that you can do. Like even in your sleep, even when you're sick. I mean, that's how I found myself, because there's some things that I can actually just sit down, even when I'm not feeling too well, I could just pick up my pen and just start sketching, and I'll just make stories and just do stuff. At that point, I just knew that, okay, I can do this while I'm sick, I can do this while I'm happy, I can do this when I'm going through stuff, I can do this when I'm, you know, that's how you know your core. I don't know if I'm talking to somebody here, but you just know that this is what you want to do for the rest of your life. Whether it pays you or doesn't. It keeps you sane, keeps you grounded. I don't know. This one is difficult questions to ask, but something to advise, because the thing is, everybody here, you're going through different life. You're going through life differently. Like, my life is not yours. I can't possibly say I feel your shoes or how you feel, because, I mean, people have different lives. I didn't lose my mom. Some people lost their parents, lost brother. You know, people have different things they have to go through. But then eventually, there's something about every human spirit is your core. You just have to find it. And if you found your core and you found what you're good at, just explore it. Just tap into it. Just tap into it. Tap into it. That thing is going to make you successful. that I can guarantee. I don't care. I can guarantee anything. But just tap into it. Tap into it. We all have that thing, and I think everybody's got it. It's, I mean, for me, when I studied law, right, I was average. It was cool. I mean, if I focused on it, maybe I would have succeeded, maybe I would have not, you know. But then I was just average. But the moment I focused on art, of course, I knew I wasn't average. I was like, people who even studied it couldn't meet up because I was way ahead of people already because that was my core. I just kind of understood that. And also put the passion to me to work my ass off. So, yeah. I hope I answered the question, but I hope I try to say something. Thank you so much for listening to me.